Okay, so always prefatory comments, but I'm not going to be very detailed on it. Since my talk, the way I have changed my paper, because I always change my paper after I've handed it in, is towards basically a more traditional Chinese religious world making understanding of my topic. I do not think you can talk about religious world making in traditional China if you confine yourself to Buddhist or Taoist or popular or whatever. So normally I could give a whole talk on these labels. I will not do that here. So let's start with this very, very famous picture. It's not so important for our Chinese audience. They can just use the Chinese terms, but in a Western audience, we have terms such as pure land, Jingtu. Pure, I think, maybe refers more to the incarnated persons than the location. But most importantly, we use the term Western paradise as a translation for Xifang Jide Shijie. And that's a bit confusing because the term paradise in the West usually refers obviously to the Jewish Christian paradise, to the Islamic paradise, which is a garden, and it has no buildings to speak of. Well, you look at this picture or many other pictures of the Pure Lands in the Chinese context, it's palatial, it's almost urban in nature. Yeah, it's bigger than a palace. I think it looks more like a city even. And so in that sense, the term paradise does not quite fit what Chinese imagination was when they would put things onto a wall. Generally, when you have text quotations, at least the text quotations that I have found, people seem to imagine the larger location in line with their social background, which in practice meant they focus on the lotus pond. It's a famous symbol. The roots of the lotus are in dirty soil at the bottom of the pond. The roots go up to the leaves, and then the lotus flower is raised on the stalk a little bit above the leaf that floats on the water. So even though you have bad karma or dirty karma, you can become a lotus flower, as it were. Now, anecdotes, at least the anecdotes that I have seen, and I have obviously not seen everything, anecdotes rarely mention this larger architecture. They talk about the lotus flower. And when you talk about narratives, they always turn on a plot twist. Yeah, either the plotist is, they are very simple people like nannies, courtesans, that kind of people. They practice simple worship, Namo Amitofo, and they still attain rebirth in the pure land, which is then made explicit, because they see a lotus flower and they are carried away on the lotus flower or on the Lianhua. I hope they are carried away on the lotus leaves. Monks, another plot twist is that monks and abbots are not certain of rebirth in the Pure Land. They might want to, but I have not found a single story, traditional non-doctrinal story, in which monks and abbots become, are reborn in the Pure Land. What I did find, and that's crucial to my talk today, what I did find is that the Pure Land in these narratives is often explicitly connected to the underworld, either that you want to be free of the underworld, or that you do not receive punishment. Yeah, so the Pure Land and the underworld are intricately connected together. You can't explain the one without the other. And you find this in miracle stories. I quote a few examples. You find it in new religious movements, the White Lotus movement of the Sun Yuan period, the non-action teachings of the late Ming to present period, and you find it in funerary practices. Just one example, the English translation sort of is on page 10 in my paper. Here is the Chinese, and I've just marked with letters the crucial words, which is here that the lady who has died reports how she has gone to the underworld. I came to the bridge in the underworld offices, to the site of the bridge, in the underworld offices. So we have a bridge, that's important. Jing Da Guan Fu, so we came by a big yamen, the offices of the office officials. Here, we cross, they go back because she's sent back to life again. So they crossed over the bridge. Here we have a water pavilion full with water, the whole pond filled with red and white lotus flowers. And then here she drops into the water. Now, what do we see? For one, we get information on underworld geography. I should explain the water. Falling into the water, jumping into the water is a very common liminal moment in these stories. It is the moment that a dead person returns to life, or a person is reborn in a new incarnation. So water marks, yeah, the moment of transformation of one form of existence into another form of existence. After all, you could also become an animal. And in this case, in this particular story, the water, that's just a traditional liminal point in these narratives, actually is the same as the lotus pond from Pure Land narratives. And this way you can look at a lot of the narratives and you find that underworld and Pure Land are connected together. The same is true of Qing to present funerary ritual. Why do I say Qing? Because I have not been able to find complete descriptions of funerary ritual before the Qing. You find information, ritual, but only the Buddhist part and not the rest. And the rest is quite a lot. The funerary ritual is much more than just the Buddhist and Taoist merit making. It also includes dealing with the so-called sha or sheng. It's a rapacious bird that returns with the soul of the deceased, the huan soul. It returns to the corpse of the deceased a few days after he or she has died. And it's very important that you have rituals to deal with this advent, because this bird is really rather nasty. So it's a common practice, and this practice can be dated centuries back, long before the Qing dynasty, that you have an exorcist ritual often performed by what we today call Taoist priests to expel this sha or sheng, or whatever it's called locally, creature. You have a variety of smaller exorcist ceremonies because the soul is dangerous. These ceremonies are also part of the funerary practice. There's ancestral sacrifice, and most importantly today, there is ritual theater. We know this from some descriptions that I will talk about below or later in a few moments. There is the Mulian story. I hope everybody knows the Mulian story, the story that basically informs at the ghost festival that can be performed at funerary occasions. We have a description from Fujian, several descriptions from Fujian. We have the Dachun, the destruction of the underworld, the destruction of hell. We have the passage of Fire Mountain by the Tang monk, Xuanzang. And we have the enactment of the reaching of the Pure Land. And maybe at the grave you have a lament, a bit similar to the bridal lament. So also at the grave you can have a lament of the dead. And the experts can be all kinds of people, not just Buddhists and Taoist priests. Now, what evidence do I have that goes beyond prescriptive normative ritual descriptions? Interestingly and curiously, and that's how I first encountered actually funerary ritual myself in the 1990s, in Tian Ti Hui. So that is the triads. In the triad, or Hongwen, or whatever, it has many names. Tian Ti Hui ritual is an inversion, a turning around of funerary ritual, or maybe it's just an application of funerary ritual in which someone symbolically dies, and after his, it's always a man, after his death, he's reborn through the water. And this ritual includes a passage through the underworld and the story of crossing Fire Mountain. So what are our sources? There is this inversion of the funerary ritual, and there's late 19th century description. I think it's the best and most complete description we have of any part of China by De Groot, De Groot in Dutch, sorry for the Dutch G sound, in Chinese known as Gao Yan. Jan de Groot, Gao Yan. He's the first of any linguistic or cultural background ever in China to do field work. He did field work for 5 years in the 1880s, not as a missionary. He was never ever a missionary. He was a translator. That was his job, but he did 5 years of field work to understand Chinese culture in Fujian. Yet to support the colonial government of Chinese in the Dutch Indies, now Indonesia. He gives a very complete description that's not so well known. And this description is confirmed by other people's field observations. Piet van der Loon, Kamada Shigeo, Kenneth Dean, I have seen some myself. Benjamin Rosen at this moment, almost literally, he's writing about a part, the passage of Fire Mountain, because he's studying how Xuanzang is represented in Chinese culture. Now, these ritual segments, just to put it back to mind, I'm talking about the ritual theater, not about funerary ritual, merit-making ritual by Buddhists and Taoist priests. The ritual theater, this ritual theater is not well described. The destruction of hell is, but the other parts are often ignored. Or if someone has written about it, you can send me an email and I will be very happy. This is the description by the Grote. He describes how Buddhist ritual specialists enact the passage to and through the Pure Land. So it's not something that's expressed in words, it's represented at the funeral. That is to say, the funerary ritual enacts the journey to the Pure Land, but it is part of first the passage through the underworld, performance of Boolean plays, and then you have the passage through the Pure Land. So they are all connected together. And we do not have time for this, but you can look at it later on. So world-making is not a single element. World, like Buddhist or Taoist or Christian or Islamic or literary for that matter, it must mean the world-making by people living in China, and that must include the complete picture. And the complete picture can be told in a narrative, miracle stories, and so on. And it can be represented in funerary ritual. And at least in the Fujianese region, maybe the only region, and I include Taiwan in that, the only region where we have good detailed ethnography, in the Fujianese region, the Pure Land visit, the passage through the Pure Land, and the travel to the through the underworld are always combined together. Yeah, and it would make no sense to put a label on it because that's not how local people see it, since they do not have the word Buddhism or Taoism. These are Western terms from the very late 18th and early 19th century. And this world making occurs independent of the doctrinal affiliation of the performers or the audience. This is the world that the traditional Chinese lived in, some of them still live in today, and they enacted it in funerary ritual and they talked about it in anecdotes, miracles, and so on and so forth. And that concludes my presentation.